Let's talk about the biggest story, forget sports, in the world right now. Mr. Sean Diddy Combs. We know what came out a year ago at this point now with him being abusive to Cassie and things like that. Little did we know. I would say little did we know. I feel like a lot of people knew. I feel like it was one of Hollywood's worst kept secrets, but I digress. He's going to jail. In fact, he's in jail currently as he has basically a RICO charge up against him.
I was on suicide watch.
Yeah, he's on suicide watch. I was wondering why he's walking around Harlem in New York last week. He was getting this Bobby Axelrod from season 2 on. We knew the nigga was going to jail, sex trafficking, a whole bunch of other things. They denied his bail twice, and he's going to be in there till trial time, and I don't think we're going to see him out of there, man. Lara, what's your opinion on everything that's been going on, not just with this case, but just this week in general?
Bro, I mean, for me, I was, you know, I made a little bit about it, but I really was concerned more with the 1,000 bottles. That was crazy to be, like, talked about to me. It was like 1,000 bottles. And reading the some of the document, I didn't read too much, but I read some stuff about the what he could possibly have been using them bottles for, which was some other crazy shit, which it's just like, I don't know. It's like, it's crazy. Like I talked to somebody over the week from Chicago. I won't mention any names or anything because this is going to sound crazy, but they said, man, you know, R. Kelly should be in jail, but I feel bad for him because he went through some things that made him the way he is, but I don't feel shit for Diddy. Cause that nigga had a degree. He could read and write. Like, nigga. So I feel the same way. Like, in a way, like, man, to keep people trying to compare the two situations, totally different situations. I don't think it's any underage stuff with the R. Kelly thing. I mean, with the Diddy thing, we don't know yet, but that man had everything in his possession. He could get anything he wanted. He carried himself like that for too long, and it's caught up with him, bro. You can't be a unforgiving boss forever, man. You can't be being arrogant on TV and making people walk to get your cheesecake in different boroughs and shit. It's just so many things we saw from, I would say, the mid late 90s till now add up to what's going on as we speaking right now. It's unfortunate, but I also heard he won't be getting out. I mean, probably ever, but I heard they won't be starting trial till probably like 2026 or 27 is what I heard. Which means he's gonna be sitting in there until then. Hopefully he doesn't kill himself. I don't want nobody to kill himself, but I definitely like to see people have to face what they fucking did too. Like, you can't just get out here on the easy route. I don't think he's gonna do that though, man. He listens to a lot of gospel music.
Yeah, I'm the exact opposite. I'm the exact opposite. I think, bro, Larry, I think he's gonna off himself, G. I don't think he sees trial. I think his ego is so high that this is really gonna break him down being in that prison cell. And I don't think he's gonna make it. But I think more than anything, you know, we talk about abuses of power and everything and the influences. And even though I think his former bodyguard Gene, nigga, you should be in jail too because you watched all this shit happen.
Man.
But, you know, one thing he said the other day that was real, and it was like, you got to think about it. He learned this shit from his mentors, from Clive, from Russell, from, you know, people who have all had, you know, several allegations about them throughout their career. So it's like, he watched these things, and then once he got the power, he was like, okay, now I'm about to do this. So I think it's one of those situations where, you know, the chickens finally came home to roost, and he's going to be under the jail, but I think you don't want to see anybody kill themselves, but I truly believe his ego is that large that you're not gonna see him make it to trial. Just off the strength that even after all this came out, you would still catch him wandering around Miami, you know, trying to just, you know, he was missing that attention because that's all his life has been the past what 40 years? You feel me? 30, 40 years. So it's one of those things where, you know, as much as we love the culture, it's one of those things where this is an icon that clearly probably needed to be taken down because it's like, bro, you've just gotten too drunk with power and you've just abused people for decades and this shit, just, it has to stop at some point. So this is one of those situations. I don't want to hear none of you niggas saying that, oh, but the white man got to do this. Like, stop. Like, we're not doing that. I saw some people trying to tie it to him suing the liquor company and all the other shit. Stop. Like, just stop, bro.
So
I do got an opinion on that though, real quick. I do think it does stem from that in a way, but that doesn't say he didn't do any of the shit. They was just like they do with everybody else in the world. They protect each other. But when you become a liability, hey man, we got to get you the fuck out of here. That's what I think. My bad, Japan.
The only reason why I disagree is because he was the one that was opening up his mouth. We talked about this even before all of this came down. I remember when I had his Scott, when Puff was playing us the music from the Love album, and this was in 2021. And I remember somebody asked, he was not in person. He was in his studio, but we were in Atlanta. I remember when somebody asked him who was the inspiration for the album. And he said, Kim Porter, he said, Young Miami, and he said, Cassie, all of the women that he dealt with. And I remember telling somebody, yo, he got to leave that Cassie shit alone. Then the album does not drop. Then when he drops it, he's going through press runs, and he's continually saying Cassie's name. He's at the BET Awards, accepting his Lifetime Achievement Award. And he defiantly says, you know, no thanks, Cassie. So I think that was one of those situations where probably on the back end, what we don't know is that his ass and her was probably going through their thing, and then he tried to call her bluff. I literally believe if Puff does not try to call her bluff and Puff pays whatever that freight that he needed to pay, we wouldn't even be having this conversation. But as Scott said on this program and on other programs so many times, Kid Icarus, man, you out here flying close to the sun. Too close to the sun. And I think that's what Diddy did. But then when you read the indictment, that indictment is wild. Because, yeah, this shit could have been happening before 2008. But it says from at least 2008 on. If we know anything about what was going on around 2008, outside of Diddy Dirty Money, it wasn't a lot of shit that was going on at Bad Boy. In fact, that shit was really saving Bad Boy at the time. So my man was really, if the indictment, what you see in the indictment is true, my man really thought he was freaky Frank Lucas. He really thought he was freaky Frank Lucas. I'm going to do this. I'm not going to sell drugs. I'm not going to do any of that shit right here. But I'm just going to get all of these hoes in one hotel and say, hey, we gonna do this, and you on your phone, and you got surveillance, and you sit up here watch people have sex and shit. That was your vice. Now, he was acting like a mob if you look at the Kid Cudi shit, which is documented in there, and then plus, of course, his abuse and all of that stuff. But yeah, he felt like he was a mob boss, but instead of selling drugs and shit, he was selling pussy. Freaky Frank Lucas. And it might be a situation where he get what he deserved.
I mean, I look at it like this, man. All you can't keep moving the way he was moving for these last 30, 35 years and thinking just wasn't going to come down on you. Number one, with the feds ain't the regular police, brother. When the feds ask you questions like your girl asked you questions, she already know the answer 9 times out of 10. This is something what they've been investigating for a long time. And there's a lot of weird stuff that we always see on Twitter when like a black man gets arrested. Niggas always go to, what about Weinstein? What about this? What about that? Weinstein about to die in jail, my niggas. I don't even know why we keep bringing that up. Number one. And number two, this is something, you know what I'm saying, that it just shows you that this dude has been a deviant to begin with. You know what I'm saying? And that's something that, you know, I have no, you know, what's the word I'm looking for? Sympathy for him. And this was somebody who's a massive Diddy fan. I'm not going to sit up here and act like I wasn't a Diddy fan just because of what is happening. But this is somebody who he really thought he was a joker. He really thought he was Harvey Dent. Like, you're seeing all this stuff that has happened just out in front. Like, if you read the actual indictment, it's way crazier than what we thought it was. And another thing to me that stands out is all the jokes. Like, people doing too much with the jokes as well. Like, some stuff just ain't funny. And I also feel when it comes to everybody being having a hard on for one Jay-Z to get in trouble for whatever reason, this is something where I don't think it's gonna be something where there's gonna be mad names that's gonna come out, because it was just the feds. This is the feds. There were other names they had, they'd be in this involved as well. These are not conversations just that's happened overnight. You know what I'm saying? These are conversations that happen where This was, I'm pretty sure he got arrested. It was arranged. Like, okay, we're going to come get you on this day.
Well, so all no. those interviews so actually, happened. Real quick, Scott, actually, it was arranged that he would get arrested on Tuesday. But what happened is they found that pink ecstasy shit inside of his room or whatever. They knew that he had it on him. So they was like, ah, man, fuck it. Let's go ahead and get this shit over with. They you know, they didn't want to try to have Buddy Ass do the perp walk, but he ended up having it inside of the hotel room. Because if you look at the TMZ got the footage. They went and just slid on his ass.
Yeah, but go ahead, Lara.
I was just going to say, with the whole situation, like, I agree with everything you said about the extra parts of it where people are trying to make up excuses, bringing up the white man and bringing up R. Kelly even and all of those things. I think that shit is it's unnecessary because we watched this shit go on. We watched a video of this man not too long ago. Like you said, bang, he blew up a nigga car within the last 20 years. He blew somebody car up. It's other rumors about things that he's done that may come to light when this shit is all over. But I you know, I'm just like you, Scott. I was a fan. I had to let all this shit go back with Kels. When my favorite people do bad, how can I stand with them? I won't. And I don't understand why people was mad about Quincy either. That shit is crazy. Like, I can't believe I'm so disappointed in Quincy. Quincy don't fucking know you, bitch. Why do y'all care about me?
Right.
That's they did. You know what I'm saying? At the end of the day, that's their father. We don't know. I don't know how they deal with the stuff with their mama. I don't want to get into that too much because all of these things are going to come to light. And even with some of the people that may have helped him get arrested, may have helped had a part of these, may be suing him. Some of these people are also going to be looked at differently when this shit come out. Like when the shit is really open and when the shit is really going forward, it's you know, it's going to be a few people that's going to, you're gonna be like, damn, I couldn't believe you did. Like, I mean, just knowing how this shit go, man. It's people, all people have their vices. I wish his was different. And then the whole, like you said, bang about the selling, he was basically like selling sex. I'm really concerned with what I read. I didn't read the whole thing, so I need to go back and go through it. But if I'm not mistaken, he was like watching live porn.
Yeah. Yes, he was. He was getting reportedly, allegedly, bringing commercial sex workers. I'm trying to find out the word commercial sex workers, because even that's weird to me. He was flying them in locally, nationally, internationally. They were renting rooms and hotels. His people would put lighting and oils and all types of shit, make sure a camera and that. All in these rooms, and he would sometimes be in them and doing their things, but a lot of times he was just watching it and having sex. He would be in situations where it'd be happening in front of him, and he'd just be having like meetings, and he'd be having conversations with people. It was almost like people having sex in front of him was like a lampshade or some shit. Like, yeah. That's what it was, and that's the wild part of this, and it's gonna make. I said this on some dude. It's going to make Black Hollywood look kind of weird, right? Because remember, ain't no party like a Diddy party, right? So if it's no party like a Diddy party and there's other people who have tried to mimic Diddy parties, I don't know if y'all saw the video a couple of months ago that they reposted on the Neighborhood Talk, but one of the girls that was with Neo was yelling at him, so what about those free calls? What about this and what about that? And reportedly, allegedly, Neo was a witness to all of this stuff too. So it's a lot of shit that's gonna go on. But this is not enabling, right? Because with the Kels thing, I get some of it because he had a lot of enablers. Mm-hmm. These are not enablers. These were employees. Mm-hmm. Like if you got people that's going up in the hotel rooms or in rooms basically putting up lighting and putting up oils and shit, and then you got people coming in with IVs, because they say some of these shits will happen for days. Mm-hmm. Like, not one night. This shit was happening for days. That means you have a network of people who are involved in this too. And they're not going to go to jail because those are going to be the people that snitch on Diddy. All these people talk about some Jay-Z, talk to these people. No, the people that's going to tell is the people that Puff was ordering to supply these rooms with the things he needed so he could beat off.
Also, something we didn't speak about, which is interesting to me. When he originally, when they went to his place, the terminology might be off, but I'm not sure that they actually raided his home. Those first two times when they went to LA and they went to Miami. But it's interesting to me that they didn't arrest anybody at that time. Yeah. They went in there, they came out with a box of evidence or whatnot, which is more than likely to me what I would think, because everything is a conspiracy. They protecting who they got to protect. You know, I think that's why I also think you're not going to see a lot of people's names in certain stuff, because they went through there and got some stuff that they needed to get before they even started this whole thing. And then it's the same house that he was trying to put up for bail. And he also has another house out there and other properties. They didn't raid any of the other properties. They only raided those two specific ones because they probably were tipped off. That's where he was keeping his stuff at. But I'm just guessing there. But it's a little crazy.
You know, I agree. I think the two houses that got raided were the houses that they got tipped off of. It's like, yo, these the freak off houses. Mm-hmm. So it was going to be shit there for them to find, which, I mean, a lot of the stuff from the New York indictment lines up with everything Cassie was saying, from like the beatings and like just different situations in different places. And so I think, like we said, and everybody said this, but like anytime you see coordinated stings on occasions, it's because somebody told them something. Like they not finna just... Randall, okay, on Tuesday, we're going to run into both of these cribs at the same time. Like, no, they knew that was the perfect time to go in there.
They knew what was on the premises.
Yeah, they knew what was there and what they needed to get. And that's why I think slowly but surely you will see some things leak. And I'm with Bang as far as the whole Black Hollywood thing, who you'll see. But I think at the end of the day, they're going to keep the focus on him, because I said this in the chat. I'm sure there were some consensual freak offs that took place. Like, let's just be honest about this. Like, I'm not even trying to be funny. Yeah, no, it's funny, but I'm not trying to be funny. Like, there was some consensual.
I'm not laughing. I'm laughing at the word freak off. I'm laughing at the word freak off being in a U.S. government indictment.
Bro, in an indictment. But, like, no, I think there were some consensual situations where you had a bunch of people who were rich and famous and powerful who came in behind closed doors. We're going to do some drugs and we're going to party and we're going to fuck and we're going to go home. But at the same time,
did you see video of Neo, Baby Mama, and yelling at him, talking about, tell him about the freak-offs. Tell him about the freak-offs.
Exactly, bro. Like, I'm sure it's plenty of folks who was there. Like to Larry's point, G, since we were shorties, they've been saying, ain't no party like a Diddy party. Yeah. It just became taboo to talk about Diddy parties in that sense, where people be like, hey, he be wilding. Like, it just got to that.
It felt like Breakfast Club kicked that shit off when they was playing his videos back to him and kind of like making fun of him in a way, but he wouldn't really react as much. And people felt like, oh, Diddy ain't really about to kill nobody. We about to talk shit about this nigga, because it been a super thing, this party thing. Like, now it's a negative light. But even before he got arrested, people was like, nah, I ain't never been to no Diddy party, because they already was like saying, like, without saying what it is going on. But like, man... Somebody said Demi Foxx about to never have another party again. No.
That's what I said.
But this shit is wild. And it's so many different theories that you could believe in, because, bro, like, most of the stuff we grew up hearing about this man is coming to fact. Like, we grew up hearing about the crazy freakiness. We grew up hearing about the power tripping. Him may have slapping somebody in public. Him may disrespect another superstar in public. And we've heard about all of these things.
And him trying to fight Kendrick over the King of New York thing.
That story done got more elaborate. Like, oh my God.
And I feel like every video I see from him from the past, like, I don't know. I saw a video today when Kenan Ivory Rands had his short-lived late night show, and he had Puff on there and he had Mike Tyson on there. And looked like Puff was trying to cop a film. Mike Tyson took that nigga hand, moved it, and then like he sat like on the side of the couch like it's just like stuff you start to see, and it's just like, it's kind of weird, because it's like, I always kind of knew Puff was a little crazy. I ain't think he was like this. And like, even if you go back and look at a show that I love, Making a Band, some of that stuff ain't funny no more.
Yeah.
Now it's that really you not, know how he is.
He really looks like a maniac. And like, I mean, there was one clip where him and Cassie were on the red carpet. And like you said, hindsight is 2020 now, but like, you see him mouthing something to her and she looks like fucking terrified. And like, it's one of those things where, you know, throughout the years, people, like, when he did Get Him to the Greek, everybody was like, you know, Puff, that's not a character. Yeah. That's really how he
acted. I seen that happen in person. Like, I seen that I seen that moment for Get Him to the Greek happen in person. And when I saw it, I was like, yo, that nigga, that's a true story, huh? That's how he really be acting. But like I said, man, and it's not even a joke. I'm dead serious. Freaky Frank Lucas. Where's Frank Lucas from? Where he get his money at? Harlem. Mm-hmm. What did Puff Daddy used to do? He used to run numbers in Harlem. He used to run numbers with Nicky Barnes and all of those people.
I thought he ran numbers with Frank Lucas. It was Nicky Barnes?
It was Nicky Barnes.
It was Nicky.
Yeah, it was Nicky.
And they popped him because they thought he was snitching.
You're right. Yeah. So I truly believe, and I've believed this for quite some time. I truly believe that once Puff got to where he was Puff Daddy, that's why he always repped Harlem. That's why we always talked about Harlem. His daddy wanted to run Harlem. His daddy didn't get to do that because he was killed when Puff, I think, was like 2 years old. Puff ran Harlem. Puff fashioned himself like Nicky Barnes and his dad and Frank Lucas and all of these Harlem niggas. He ran Harlem. But in this case, he ain't running through drugs unless somebody's about to tell me he was running drugs and all that stuff. Then, okay, cool. But he didn't run it through from that. He ran it through sex and violence. Mm-hmm. Everything revolved around women. So when I say he's Freaky Frank Lucas, it is not to joke around. He was a freak version of all of the niggas that people grew up idolizing in Harlem. Those niggas.
Yeah, man, I'll say this, and then, Lara, I just have one more question for you, not Diddy related. I'll say this. First of all, I want you niggas to actually know what sex trafficking means. I've seen too many people think that just means fly out. Sex trafficking is not fly outs, my nigga. Like, flying workout is just one part of the dastardly crime that is sex trafficking. I know y'all stupid out there, but quick Google search, clear that up. On a non-Diddy subject before we wrap this show up, Lero, is there anything in the culture that stood out to you this week outside of the Diddy situation?
Oh, man. Honestly, not really, bro. Like, this thing is taking over like Drake and Kendrick did for that moment. Yeah. I don't even know what... I'm sure something has happened this week, but...
Future album came out last night.
Didn't hear it yet.
I heard half of it. I haven't been able to, like, divulge, but I listened to it on the way to Indianapolis this weekend.
Fire.
I heard, like, 3 songs... But I was hung over like a mug today. Like I met CeeLo last night, y'all. So like I was in a whole different world. I mean, even though CeeLo, some shit happened with him too. But anyway, like I just want to stay away from all niggas who got problems with women. That's what I want to do. If you don't know how to treat women, stay the fuck away from me. I don't
stay away from me, bro.
Like this whole, even the. I don't mean to get back to it, but the way people respond and react, like your first thing is to say they after this man. Your first thing is to, and it's people with kids, with daughters, wives. It's like, yo, like, you know, some of the people weren't willing to be there. Like they might've wanted to be there. Like what I read was like some of the girls who thought they was coming to get with Diddy and ended up having to be with male prostitutes for his enjoyment for hours on hours, if not days. And to the point where they was giving him IV, and it's like, yo, how do you defend that? Where do we go wrong where we think that that's just having sex? Like, he just because he freaky? Like, nah, he not just licking feet, my nigga. He he doing some things, bro.
He not a toe boy, nigga. He doing a lot.
And it's like, bro, we have to stop as men, especially. We got to stop allowing certain shit and being around certain shit because it's just like at some point, if you don't correct the cycle, there's going to be another person that we all love what they did for us or musically, we love their music or what they contributed to the culture. And then we're going to have to see the dark side of them and pull them back and pull them down. And the only way to stop these niggas from getting up and getting pulled down is to stop these niggas from the jump. Like, you got to stop the behavior first. We can't keep on doing this. We let shit slide because they are who they are. Shit, fuck that. Let's get some clean niggas up at the top. I'm tired of people. You wouldn't have to do nothing. If you didn't do nothing, they wouldn't have to pull you down. That's my point. Yeah.
And we'll wrap it up with something you actually tweeted, Lero. Stop going out your way talking about y'all still listening to Diddy and R. Kelly, bro. Nobody asked y'all niggas. Y'all doing too much for the attention. Y'all trying to be defiant, and you just look like a weirdo. But
yeah, real quick on that. So what? You still listen to Diddy. But here's the thing. There's a difference between listening to Diddy and there's songs featured or executive produced by Diddy. If your ass is sitting at the crib trying to show everybody you cool because you listen to Press Play, you lame as fuck in the first place for him. Yeah. Like, right.
If it's Case, Lil' Kim, stuff that he just might say his name on and then leave.
Oh, he said, take that.
Yeah, right. I might turn the song off the Nipsey's album just because he on there talking. I might turn that part off. Like, you know what I'm saying? It's very easy to get around the Diddy shit. They going out their way with that shit. Double hat trick, I know the code too. Ice tray, go for trade, yeah, we cold too. Getting paper on these player haters, old news. Money on the other line, so I'm not gonna hold you. Money on the other line, so I'm not gonna hold you. Money on the other line, so I'm not gonna hold you. Money on the other line.